Right, good morning. I'm going to be talking about some work that I'm currently doing with Mike in Saxonic on the Saxon product about in trying to improve the pattern matching performance. And this is work that's ongoing, literally working on it at the moment. The synopsis, some XSLT frameworks basically use generic patterns with predicates rather than normal ones where you match named elements and attributes. And these can have very high pattern matching costs. And what I'm going to be talking about effectively is improving the performance of these by investigating the pattern matching, looking at the mechanisms to improve it, including common pattern preconditions, and what I call other oracle possibilities, and how we might think about configuring such tuning in practice. Some apologies. If you are not familiar with XSLT, I'm sorry. You're not going to make much of a head or tail of this one. And we are going to discuss a specific XSLT stylesheet framework, the Dittero T, in some detail, operating on a specific engine, i.e. Saxon, since that's the one I'm working in the background of. And as our American friends say, your mileage may vary and may vary considerably. Right, what I've got to talk about is the push operation in XSLT, because you've got to understand what the arguments are coming. The big power of XSLT is in its push mode of operation. You take effectively a node or some item and you find patterns that match it, templates that have patterns that match it, and then you execute the appropriate piece. And this allows you to do things like have a library and then import that library and override it with rules of higher precedence and priority and similar things. It's probably the most powerful thing in XSLT, all working effectively on XML source and result trees. And so what happens is we're in somewhere in the source tree and we're at a current node, and somebody basically says, or some instruction says, apply the templates against that, against some set of nodes derived from that node using an XPath expression. In this particular case, I've chosen effectively all the leaf nodes underneath that node. And the templates that we're dealing with are all can be registered to be respond in particular modes, so there is a mode control. And what happens is there's a big field of templates, and in the examples I'm going to choose, there are about 600 of these. And the system basically finds each of these templates has effectively, or many of them have match patterns, which are a degenerate form, a modified form of XPath expression. And if it matches and you've determined what's going to go on, then you execute the instructions that that template contains to produce some result out. Now, what the standard says is this process of the pattern matching, or particularly the choice of templates, is a six-stage process and a declarative stage process. And what it does is as follows. You've got a whole string of templates. And from those, you choose those that have a match pattern, because it's possible to have named ones that effectively act as functions, and the mode that basically equals has been registered as being the one that's current. I know it's not equal to current, but it's the same thing. That reduces the number of templates quite substantially. You then evaluate the match pattern for the context item for each of those, and find those which are true, and that produces a smaller set. And then you choose from that the ones that have the highest import precedence. And the importation precedence basically means if you have a style sheet that's being imported, all the templates in there have a lower import precedence than the one in the importing style sheet, which basically means it's possible to have overriding. You can override in a style sheet above a library that you're importing. And then from that, you choose those that have the highest pattern priority. And patterns basically have, can either be given a specific priority, or they can have default priority, which is based on the complexity of the pattern, such that more specific patterns have higher priority than less specific patterns. And you can find all these details in Mike's book or in the standards as you want to deal with it. Now, this is where it gets interesting, because what you now get down to is the selected template set. These are the ones that should be active. If that set is empty, then the result is null. Nothing is written and you just carry on going. Okay. If it's exactly one, then you execute the template body with the context item you're dealing with and carry on going. If, however, it's two or more, it's either an error or you choose the last in the sequence in the whole system. And it's an implementation decision at the moment. In XSLT3, it may well become a controllable decision as to what happens then. And a lot of our problems in what we're going to have come from this last, these here, the big problem we're going to find. Right, what Saxon does, that one basically says what it should be. It doesn't say how you should implement it efficiently. What Saxon does is the following. It takes the whole sequence of these, and for those that are patterns that are specifically about named elements and attributes, it basically classifies them into hash tables, or hash sets. So, for example, all the ones that for element alpha 1 and all that are in Bravo, and it then orders them in what we call rank order, which basically means import precedence before priority, and then in the priority, then we reverse order them in terms of sequence. And that basically means we can do a very quick search, and it works quite well for lots of things. But we still have a lot of pieces that basically don't mention a particular name for an attribute or an element, and they have these and we keep them in order, and we actually have to go effectively, if we've got an alpha, we have to look through this lot first, and then we have to check whether there's anything in here which has a higher rank than that one. This mechanism has been in place for, 10 years, Mike? Something of that?
Easily.
And works very well on lots and lots of style sheets and things like that. But there are some it doesn't. And the example we're going to work out is one that it doesn't want. Let's look at one vocabulary of considerable size that somebody near the back knows very much about. It's DocBook. DocBook is an architecture where, for documentation, including the proceedings for this conference, where it basically uses named tags effectively as the main part of the structural description of the document, and this is a list item. And the main style sheets for dealing with this match specifically, for example, it matches a list item that's a child of an itemized list. And this works very well in Saxon because we can index against these things and zoom in heavily. However, there is a competitor or a different sort of documentation environment that's used quite considerably in very complex technical documentation, which is DITA. And there, you might think it's got the same sort of thing, that it's got a UL with an LI underneath it. However, the real meaning is in here. It's actually loaded on the class attributes. There's some structuralism there. It's a series of effectively tokens giving some meaning. For example, here is a code phrase, which is a phrase in the topic domain and a code phrase in the programming domain. And the consequence of this is that the big framework that the defining framework for processing this, DITA OT, actually contains templates that look like this. And it's actually from XSLT1, mostly, because there's no tokenized things. It's actually using this to space tag space to deal with. And in fact, it makes sure that things have spaces on the front and back. And so now we're into a situation where this is going to be effectively expensive. So what happened was one of Saxonica's clients had a performance issue which was actually unrelated to this. It was another area that we managed to fix. But in the process, we started to investigate, with his permission, this particular transformation, which is quite sizable. It's basically, the input is a DITA document of about 13,000 elements. 2.6 meg, you can see the figures there, it's all in the proceedings. And we studied effectively the process where we take this flattened DITA document into XSLFO and then to PDF through the transform topic to FO target within the build set. And that one produces an output which is about 20,000 elements with about a lot more attributes because it's a lot of styling attributes and everything else. And that then produces effectively about an 80-page PDF document, which is extremely table-heavy. 260 tables in this document. It is actually the specification for an electronic component, so it's full of bit 17 means such and such, and bit 22 each such and such, and you've got nearly 5,000 table cells sitting there. Right, this piece is executed by a style sheet which imports further through 58 source files in a very flat tree. There's effectively the first one imports six, but one of those imports around about 45 style sheets, which are a mixture of the green ones are actually contain templates, the other ones contain things like attribute sets and parameter definitions, that sort of stuff. And there are 418 pattern templates being invoked for doing this one. And if we run this, and we run it on my five-year-old laptop, it takes about 8 or 9 seconds, perhaps 10, depends, to process itself through. But in that process, we discovered that 37% of the entire time is taken up literally with matching those patterns. That includes serialization and in and out, the whole, you know, all that sort of stuff. 37% of the entire time is taken literally just by, excluding compilation of the style sheet, by that pattern matching. And this study is going to show you why that's the case and what we might do about it. Well, if we look in this set of style sheets, there are about 74 modes, of which only three are significant for this particular thing. Well, there's the default general one, there's a table of contents, bookmarks. 50% of all the calls, we measured that 76,000 times was a pattern matched in this process from start to finish. And effectively, half of those were done on bookmarks, a little bit under a fifth were done on, a sixth were done on the in the general. But when we looked at the time it took, then basically almost everything is taken here. This is insignificant, even though it's half of the time. Now, why is this the case? Well, the first thing to do is to look at these modes and look at the number of templates involved. In the bookmark and the table of contents, we only have 6 or 7 templates max. That's all we're going to do. However, the default has 270 templates, of which the vast majority are actually unnamed. But it turns out only 39 of these are actually ever invoked for this particular document. If you could give me a completely different document, and this characteristics would be entirely different. But for this type, only 39 were actually matched of the 270 that were there. Right. This is the most important slide in this piece. You will find it coming in again and again. The root of all evil is tied up in here, and some of the roots for redemption are also tied up in here. What I'm plotting here is effectively there's a sequence of the template rules that are invoked for the default mode, we're plotting the rank. And basically rank means if all the ones that are same input precedence and priority have one rank, and then the one with one priority less at the same time will have a rank lower. And we then order the, we have the rules in the particular set in reverse order, so that the ones that are last are first. So, for example, that's the last at this rank, and this is the first that are in this rank in the entire sort of tree. Now, the problem comes because when you get to one of these and you check it, once you've got to here, and if that's matched, nothing, and that, this is lower rank, nothing on beyond will match, is a candidate. Oh, by the way, those who are saying, what about next match or apply imports? It's not used at all in the entire set. So, the problem is that one of the problems is if I've matched here, I've actually got to go right to the end and check to here, because it's possible the second one might match. I do not know that's not the case, in which case I have an error or I have an ambiguity. Okay. Now, if we look at the ones that were actually used, the little blue dots are all the ones that are used. And in fact, the ones circled in green are the four most important in this particular execution. And if we look here, most of them are here. I'll come back to, this is where all the table processing is. That rank is one style sheet with pretty much everyone has got the same priority and they're all concerned with table operations. And the problem, and I'll come back to the thing, is in order to process these, check those, I've got to check all the way down here before I get there. Because I cannot know whether or not something up here won't match this particular node. And if we look at the most frequent templates, one of this template here is basically up to about 28-29%. If we look at the most frequent patterns and their number of calls, you'll see that there are ones in rank 26, which is this thing on about matching PRD code phrase. So it's this code phrase matching. Okay, this is the one that really causes all the issues, because it's a topic entry in a topic row in a topic T body. It's basically table cells in the standard body. This one at the bottom is in a header, with a row in a header in a table. And since this is table heavy, this is the thing that's doing it. And not only is it basically looking at the class attribute for the node, it's also looking for at the parent, and it's also looking at the grandparent, because it's got to actually disambiguate between this and this. Okay. And this is a contain. It has to do is look at get the class attribute, take the string, and then it has to find out whether or not the string has got space topic entry in it. Now that must require you to go right to the end of the string of the class string each time to do it. You've got to at least go once you know that you've got to within the end of this, you can probably do it. But you've still got to go look at the string on the class attribute in order to do each of these things. What we did was basically instrument a system where we looked at the pattern matching time and dumped statistics into a big, huge XML file for every one of these pieces, allowing for the time that we took to actually write the piece out into the stream. And we could get things like the average and the max and the min and the quartiles and things like that. And then we could actually produce these sorts of bar charts. And then we start looking at the time involved in these patterns. So if we looked at this one, this is our most expensive. By the way, you'll see this in the paper, at class and it contains is so long, I just had to put some sort of abbreviation in for it. 31% of the time is taken by this, and these three together take about the same, about 30-ish. So we started to focus on why were these happening, and what was happening. It was fairly clear what was actually happening. Later on, I'm going to go into how we might improve it. Okay, so we look at these particular pieces, and these are the real problems. And what's actually happening is, suppose this is the one which is actually the most frequently, it's one of the most frequently matched patterns in the thing, and certainly most expensive. So suppose that one's matched, then that template has effectively searched the class attribute. Right, that's fine. Okay. But so is the one in front of it. Okay. And so are the ones in entire rank in front of that. And so are the ones in entire rank in front of that. In fact, every one of these does exactly the same thing. They're all the same. Search the class attribute, search class attribute, search class attribute. So by the time we get to here, the class attribute has already been searched 200 times and failed. Now you can say, well, why haven't you got the class? Well, it's a very generic operation in a style sheet. You can't have special cases for absolutely everything, or you might be able to think about doing that, and that's what we're trying to think about at the moment. So in one sense, a system that was designed for more generic starts to become problematic when you're doing here, and you need probably different sort of indexation mechanisms for a very specific sort of problem, unless there are other ways you can deal with it. Okay, so this is the problem. This is why this pattern matching took so long in terms of thing, because of this. Right. How might we improve it? Well, there are sort of two classes that one can think about. One is ones that are guaranteed correct for any use of the style sheet whatsoever. Okay. The second are where you can be told things from outside that would allow you to take measures that would improve performance, where the style, where it's not true necessarily for all circumstances, for all documents or anything. And that may have some other problems, some possibilities. And we're going to look at these. The one we're going to talk about first is looking at rule preconditions. Can we actually, are there mechanisms we can partition these large rule sets whilst preserving their correctness? And the simplest way of thinking about it is look at the common preconditions. Suppose we had this set of patterns for a title with one or two conditions, a parallel intersection. Of course, they all contain one precondition. None of these are true if they do not have a parent chapter. And in fact, one way of thinking about the preconditions is actually they're to exclude, i.e. it's the failure of the precondition you're really looking for, to try and exclude large chunks of what you're going on. So the first thing is, basically, if you haven't got a parent chapter, then none of these are relevant and I don't even bother looking at them. Okay. We can do something better for some cases, not all. If we know that the parent chapter exists, then this set underneath can have that pre-evaluated, because that's already true. So basically, we reduce the patterns in that place. It's not true, we can do it for everything, but we can do it for many things. Right, if we do that, well, first of all, let's look at what we might do for our DITA open toolkit framework. Well, of course, everyone's got to have a class, exists a class, but the problem with this is they all have one. So there's no point in having a precondition that everybody has. It doesn't get you anywhere. It doesn't eliminate anything. You could basically say, okay, it contains that class string I, whatever that happens to be. Well, that's no good, because then everybody has their unique, almost everybody has their unique precondition, and we don't get any commonality. So we've got to look somewhere in the middle. And what we're trying to do is to get some P preconditions, each shared by a approximately n patterns, and there are arguments about minimum work that p is approximately equal to m, which is approximately equal to the square root of the number of templates. So for our particular example, we're probably looking for somewhere around about 10, 15, maybe 20 sets of preconditions with roughly about the same number in each, if they were all scattered together. Unfortunately, if we look, one of the things we can do we've got contains class string, possible preconditions are contains any substring of that string. Okay. If that's true, then this must be true, but it will potentially reduce things. So we can look at that, and that's what we did. We looked at effectively initial substring sizes. If we just took the initial first character, well, that's no good in this case, because all these ones use space, tag, space. So all of them got space, doesn't give us any good. 2 gives us about 12 different preconditions. 3, 5 gives us about 50, 14, 6. The problem is there's one of them that basically has it's one of these topics which has quite a long, it doesn't basically reduce until we get to about 8. And unfortunately, in this particular case, we can't reduce the contains operation because it doesn't have the appropriate properties. Now, we did this. We could produce a sequence of preconditions and they're distributed across the rules and that sort of stuff.
May I just ask, yes? Where are you getting the preconditions from? Are you doing it by looking at the style sheets?
Yes, looking at the style sheets.
Okay.
Yeah, they're coming from the patterns themselves. With a pattern former that's basically doing that. So patterns on patterns. So what we do, just like this effectively, so we'd basically substring string 1, 2, and that one then becomes the precondition. We then take this to produce a whole string of preconditions. The first one contains space T, contains space P, parent contains space P, T, parent contains space P, and we index them, and then we point into them from the template set, and then when it comes to runtime, We clear all this down for the node, and then we start, and we are looking at T1, and we evaluate its precondition. It's null, so it's not been evaluated yet, so we evaluate it. It comes back false, we record that. So we know that T1 isn't going to match. So we now proceed on to T2. We find that T2 has the same precondition, zero, is one of its preconditions, and therefore it's immediately, we know that's already false, so we immediately fail, so T2 fails. Go on down. Sometime later, we come to T4, and that one says, do you contain space P? And we evaluate that one, that's true, and if that's the only precondition, then we go on and evaluate T4 to find out whether or not it's actually true. And if it is, then we've finished, or actually we then go on until we finish the current rank and stop. But if we had failed, then somebody else later who was indexing onto the same precondition would not have to check it. They're just ding. And it's done basically just by an index into an array. And if we do this, we get the sort of, for various substring things, this is basically the normal one. If we go down to two character initial substrings, it gets a bit better. Three, there's a bit of noise on these, but don't worry about that one. If we go down to eight, we basically have managed to basically almost halve the pattern matching time that we've been dealing with this. So if we did this mechanism, we'd probably end up in our thing improving performance by 15%, maybe 20% in the overall performance of the style sheet by chopping that piece from the 37% of the pattern matching that was being going on. And it's fairly consistent that goes all the way down here. Okay, that's one. The thing about this is that it's all done under conditions where the style sheets execute correctly on anything. The next ones are basically to consult the oracle. Can you tell me something about this that I cannot find out from the style sheet directly itself, but would have some help? And the most important one is mutual exclusivity of the templates. And the other one is basically telling me, actually, this data is effectively tokenized. Okay. Right. The mutual exclusivity of templates, I have two pieces, one of rules. One which I call undisambiguating rules. If you recall this end, when you came to the selected template set, if there was exactly one, then you would execute the template. If there were two or more, then you would either error or take the last. If you can tell me that within a given rank there are not going to be two matches for a given element. So for example, that question where we had an entry cell in a row which is a T-body, or an entry cell in a row which is a head T-head, and that was never going to be a case where it was both a in a T-body and a T-head, which is a possibility within this framework for DITA, because you could have multiple tags, and no schema would tell you that, because I'd have to go inside and tell you about the structures of effectively of attribute values and the sets of the possibilities for that. But if you can tell me that, then I can do something. So, for example, what it means is, if you can tell me that this mutually exclusive set, then once I've matched this one, because these are in reverse sequence order within a rank, then I don't have to check those. So that would have quite a considerable effect here on stopping having to go back, having to carry on going, checking for a ambiguity. And if we do that, and there are a mechanism we can do it by setting warnings actually on the thing, we basically make about a 10% difference in the pattern matching performance.
But if you're allowed to select the last, can't you do that anyway?
No, because you actually have to. You have to be told that you can do that. It is a style sheet option. It's an implementation option, which may or may not be supported by your implementation.
But you are the implementation.
No, No. The style sheets don't tell me that. It's the implementer who tells me that, and that was somebody who'd have to do that. So carry on. And I'll get back to questions in a second if we don't. Okay. Fairly close to the end. Right, the other one is what you might call mutual exclusivity of style sheets. Recall that this is where all the tables were. OK. okay? And they're suffering because they're all the way down here. What would happen if we could move those further up in rank, like move them to the front? If these sections are all mutually exclusive, and it turns out they are because they're basically most on topic, then if you do that, you can shift that around. Where you can do that is basically the simplest way you can do it is shift the importation from one end of the style sheet to the other. And we do that, and then we make a significant difference. We actually take that one down to here. These now get longer because basically they've got something in front of them. They've got to be in where they move down. But overall, you get a considerable improvement. But the important point is the style sheet cannot do this. The implementation of the XSLT cannot do this. It does not know that actually, in practice, there's mutual exclusivity between these particular written regimes. Somebody outside's got to be able to do that. Right, the final one on here is, remember, this basically looked like a tokenized. So if the Oracle gives us a tokenization capability, then we can change these rules into tokenized class equals topic entry. We can then postulate basically making local variables, which take the tokenization. We can then set a set of preconditions, which basically take check against that variable. And then we can reduce the rules effectively down to the precondition sets. And in fact, in XPath 3.1, there is in fact a contains token function, which may or may not be faster, actually, to be honest. My indication at the moment is it isn't. And if we do that, then we basically get about 40% improvement in the process. But that's a piece where somebody else has got to say, these are effectively tokens. Right. We do the configuration. I'm not going to very quickly go through here. By basically, at the moment, this is experimental stuff, we have patterns that basically say things like contains class at dollar starts with. Oh, sorry. Let's go back. Shouldn't do that. Let's go to the end. Okay, where we qualify some placeholder, and then we say it's going to come like this, and we do it by unifying effectively structures over XPath trees, and then we get down to these conditions. Right, the conclusions of this, these large sets of generic predicated patterns can be very expensive, especially on these sort of scales where you've got 100, 200, 300 or more of them sitting around. And DIT is paying a lot because this work use on the ACT class is concerned with potentially extensibility. It's possible to introduce new vocabularies which say this behaves in certain topic domain as such and such, and you load onto that class attribute, but you're paying a lot for it. Preconditions are practical. We could think about mechanisms for preconditions, but which ones? A lot of experimentation. I think other Oracle measures can help, but it's going to be a lot of, you're going to have to be, if you're going to be using them, you have to be very, very well aware of what's going on. You have to do training runs and things like that. People say, well, can't you check for it? Well, no, you can't actually, because the way to check is to actually do it all out fully, and by that time you've done all the work anyway. And we can tune these configurations of our patterns, and that's something that we're looking at the moment. It really is work in progress. It's not finished yet by a long, long chalk. Right, that's it. Questions?
Started off with an example file of 2.6 megabytes.
Yeah.
Did you also try different ones?
Not so far. Most of it's been focused on this one. If anybody's tried setting up the DITA environments to get ones where you can isolate a particular piece within a particular operation is quite a considerable operation. It's something you don't do more than once at the moment. So the answer, I'm well aware of that. What we're doing at this particular stage is there's a particular particularly expensive part of the transform, which threw a lot of things onto the pattern matching, so pushed quite a lot in that direction. Once it's a little bit more stable and we got the mechanisms in place, then we'll be able to deal with that. There is an appeal. If somebody's got an environment which has similar sorts of big characteristics with generics and doesn't require enormous amounts of work to get the operation environment to go, then we'd be more than interested in it. It doesn't matter how many style sheets it's got, as long as I don't have to set up large amounts of Java environment to do it. That's the problem.
As I understood, you said that the specification say that you could either raise an error or return the last one.
Yeah.
But can't you for each pattern with a given run start by the last and go the other way around?
Well, that is effectively what we do. That's saying these the ones at constant rank are actually ordered in reverse order in sequence. So well, that's exactly what you do. If you invoke Saxon with an appropriate, it will issue a warning. Actually, it won't give you an error. It will issue a well, you can set it so it will give you an error, but it normally gives you a warning.
One of the questions here is the default mode in Saxon. Is to check for ambiguities.
Yes.
You can set an option to not check for ambiguity.
Yeah.
And in a style sheet like this, that will give you a big performance win. But we tend to rank usability above performance in Saxon.
Okay. But it's already
usability that gives you warnings is worth the performance cost.
Yeah. It will give you a certain performance improvement. It won't give you it was about 10%. It won't give you the big stuff that you would want, for example, in this table, if you were dealing with a very table-heavy one.
So if I understood at the beginning, you said you've got this big document, big style sheet, and running it on your five-year-old laptop, it took 5 seconds.
It was about eight, something like that.
Is it really worth it?
Well, it depends, because this is stuff that's being done, if it's in an environment where it's being run repeatedly, for the creation of large things, it might well be. But for us, 37% of the time taken on pattern matching on with such is a target to look at to squeeze it out. It might not be relevant for this particular client because he might only do this once a day or twice a day or once every 20 minutes. But there might be another environment that's got similar sort of characteristics where basically one's being thrown out every 5 seconds. Under those circumstances, then it is important. It is useful. We have to chase down performance improvements in all points to get the thing, because the difference between a naive and an thing is orders of magnitude in terms of the performance of these pieces.
So if you adapt the style sheets and use the tokenized class and so on, this is already faster than if I would use the contains?
I've looked at the contains. It's very much dependent. But what's going to happen is if I just change it to those contains, change the contains token piece, what's happening is it's still tokenizing each time, and then it's producing a token set, and then it's comparing it. Which is, if you're doing that repeatedly, it's exactly the same. In fact, it's worse, because you've actually gone down a token and produced a set and run it. The key on this is to try to stop repeating the same work 200 times. I mean, that's where the problem comes from.
Effectively. Do you see any scope to try to infer your
Well, in some cases, of course, you could do that. But in this particular case, unless that schema document goes into the details of the space tagging inside the class attribute, which I very much doubt, and the mutual exclusivity of effectively structurally inside tags, then you're not going to get that at all. Much more practical, I think, for these, and it's something we've started to think about, is if you've got doing big amounts of this stuff, then training runs are probably one way to do it. run through this one, run representative sets, and we can potentially look at analyzing stuff from there to see whether or not there has been basically been pieces, and doing things, run it again and swap. Let's take the case where I've shifted the style sheet from one, the tables one, right up to the top. Well, I could move that, would be, it's not just a straight single line of code actually, but within some high level operation inside Saxon and the training runs, and then try it, and then compare the results. You know, have I got exactly the same value as I got from the other one? If that's the case, and you give me enough training runs and that sort of stuff, and you're prepared to accept that these are pretty much the entire set that you're going to deal with, then we can say, all right, we'll do it. The big problem there, you know, comes back to, you're taking the guarantee because the style sheet cannot do it. It cannot tell you that, you know, that something slipped through, which basically had another set of tags, which meant that your conditions weren't satisfied. Anybody else? Nope. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, John.